It's awkward. Okay, so this is based on work I did with Xiaoliang, following up on work I did with Douglas Stanford and Dan Roberts, and then a little bit that's my own work at near the end. So what I wanted to talk to you guys about today was kind of just what do operators do when we time evolve them? So let's say we have an operator in their Heisenberg picture. We can just, for intuition's sake, expand out the first couple term in the Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff series, you know, just to, or I guess it's just a lemma of the Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff. But we can just try to get intuition by seeing what happens. And there are at least three classes of what tends to happen. A generic model actually won't just have one, two, or three in it. It will tend to have a mixture of all the three. And sometimes one of them is the most important. But depending on your coupling or whatever, you can make both of them equally important. It just depends. Today, we're going to talk about a model that only has kind of really selects out one of them. And we'll see something very interesting that happens. But for the first class, and the most familiar one, the one that's been most well studied, let's just think about the, you know, the normal chaotic spin chain. So it's this Hamiltonian with these parameters, mainly for historical sake and to put in the chaotic region. So we have a single poly. And when we use a commutator with the Hamiltonian on it, we get two polys. When we do another one, we get three, two, and one polys, but all supported on this three-site region, and so on and so forth. Essentially, every time we try to take a poly and commute it, we get kind of this growing support. Essentially linearly growing with the number of times we try to apply the Hamiltonian to it. And this gets kind of just local terms in the Hamiltonian giving us this kind of geometrically local growth. That how big the region is, as you know, what rate does that volume grow at? It's just proportional to the surface area, because that's where the new terms kind of come in. You get the same kind of terms in your Hamiltonian contributing for everything you had inside, because they were already there before. But the new terms you get upon a time evolution that's going to cause it to grow come from the boundary region, the nearest neighbor terms or whatever, if you wanted to latticize, you know, your spatial derivative or something like that. And if you really want to make this sharp, you can work at infinite temperature and poly systems and establish a kind of Lieb-Robinson-like bound. You have this kind of notion that up to exponential error, an operator is supported along a certain site only after you wait a certain amount of time depending on where you started the operator. So it takes longer for an operator to be supported here if it started here than it does for it to be supported here. There's a notion of like something closer and something farther, just from having nearest neighbor like terms in our Hamiltonian. And in fact, in a Lieb-Robinson bound, you can even have crazy terms like e to the minus, you know, nearest neighbor squared divided by some parameter, as long as the like further terms kind of are supported less and less. Of course, for our sake, when we have our special relativistic systems, we don't like such terms in our Hamiltonian, so we don't use them. But I'm just saying that such a system would also have kind of up to exponential error a light cone. Now, it doesn't have to be a cone per se. It could be a diffusive type thing, depending on the model you're studying. But the idea of is of kind of like causally separated regions. Oops, down is to go forward. So one way of probing this, as we saw before, it was kind of we use the kind of norm for the biggest eigenvalue of the commutator is because this commutator is essentially a notion of how much is this operator different when I time evolve it using kind of a minimally perturbed Hamiltonian with the operator V. So if I have, you know, Hamiltonian 1 is just H and Hamiltonian 2 has H but also kind of a delta impulse proportion with V and some maybe some constant, then we know to leading order in kind of a perturbative way, the difference between these two operators is proportional to the commutator of them. Of like W and V. Now, if you just have the commutator alone, you're going to miss out on a lot of interesting things. That's why we took the kind of norm earlier. But that's usually really hard to understand kind of the biggest eigenvalue and stuff like that. What we're much more familiar with that we'd be able to access is kind of the commutator squared. Because then we can just do an expectation value of that instead of trying to do some maximization principle for the eigenvalue. But it depends on the system. Maybe that one's easier for your studying purposes. So we can study the commutator squared, or we can study kind of a piece of the commutator squared that's very interesting in certain situations, the out-of-time order correlator. It's just the ones where the W and Vs don't touch each other. And this will help us kind of distinguish the different kinds of operator dynamics. Oops, sorry again. So a system that's going to really exemplify the second type of operator dynamics without having any sort of operator propagation, in a sense, is the SYK model. That's because the SYK model doesn't have a notion of space from the start. It's just, you know, we could just think of it as like one atom or something. And like we have all these degree of freedoms like inside the atom. The atom's just shining at us with like a different intensity based on these degrees of freedom. And they're all just talking to each other in this k-local manner. This just trying to model for us some sort of system that just doesn't have a notion of space, you know? So like we might have like one Majorana and a couple to like three others at a time. There isn't a notion of Majorana 12 being closer to 1 than it is to like 17 or something. But there's still going to be an interesting structure that arises from this, because we didn't just take like a Hamiltonian out of a hat. We're taking this k-local Hamiltonian. If we took a Hamiltonian out of a hat, it would have like four q-local terms and q plus 2 and dot, 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 all the way up with certain weights. And then lastly, and most importantly, to give ourselves something that we can actually do, we're going to take in a Tuft-like limit with our coupling constants. So let's just try to get some intuition for how the operator grows. Even though this is technically not right in certain systems, let's kind of write out the first couple terms in this expansion. So we could have like one Majorana, and then we try to commute it with the Hamiltonian. This is for the q equals 4 model. So one Majorana will become three Majoranas. OK, great. That's in this term right here. And then this 3 has three different kind of Majoranas upon which the Hamiltonian might not commute to give us these kind of three types of operators right here. Or you could call this one operator by summing it together. But the idea is that we're going to get more and more terms in our Hamiltonian contributing as we go further and further down this kind of depth. So before, we would have only had some number of terms. And now we'll have some number to like a higher power and so on and so forth as we go deeper and deeper. So now, instead of this kind of geometrically local growth where the kind of size or volume of the region that the operator support on, or the Majoranas that it support on or whatever, instead of that growing proportional to the surface area, it grows proportional to the volume. So we can't really say there's a notion of like, you know, here or there for Majorana 1 and 17. There's just a bunch of them and they're doing something. So is that it? Like, do we just have to discard it and then just close our eyes and start doing calculations? Well, it turns out there's going to be a really cute structure to how this operator is going to time evolve, as we already kind of start seeing here. And we can actually make this structure very clean in a large end limit. So one other thing I should mention is that the commutator squared I said, or in this case, the anti-commutator squared, because we have fermions, it's going to diagnose this kind of growth for us. But let me get more specific about that. Let's say we take ordered product of fermions. So like psi 1, psi 2, blah, 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 then psi 1 times psi 2, psi 1 times psi 17, and so on and so forth, and then 3 products and 4 products and 5 products. As it turns out, the trace of two of these will only be non-zero if every single Majorana in one of them is in the other one. So they have to pairwise square to 1. What this means is that I've set up for you an orthonormal, or in this case orthogonal, because I haven't normalized it yet, basis of operators. And you can ask, like, well, what is it, you know, what is this, the, you know, basis for? You could say it's the basis for anti-commutations with a single Majorana element. It gives you back a number times the operator when you try to anti-commute it with a single flavor, depending on if it has that operator in it or not. Or you could try anti-commuting it with all of the flavors, and then you'll just get how many Majoranas are in that divided by the total number of flavors. So now that I've, you know, given you an orthogonal basis of operators, any O of T that I time evolve, I can expand along it just by kind of inserting a complete set of operators and get different coefficients for the different terms. Now, why does this relate? Why the hell does this matter in terms of these like O talks and commutator squares? Well, if we look at it, I insert my term right here. I'm taking a Hermitian one right here. That's why there's no dagger. We get like our projections, and then with psi 1j and psi I and psi j. OK. Now remember what I said earlier. The trace is only non-zero if every Majorana has like a partner. So these two, whatever sign is in the front, because this will either move through this or move through this with a minus sign, these two will take care of each other. So I and j have to be the same for this trace to be non-zero. OK, that's good. That's going to, you know, turn this into a something squared summed. Now, the question is, does psi j anti-commute through, you know, this product of Majorana fermions? Well, that depends on if this product has psi j in it. If it does, this won't give 0. Instead, you'll just get something proportional to like the product. If it doesn't have psi j in it, you get 0. So that means when you sum over, repeated indices j and j are summed over. So if I average over j in this case, I will get how many elements are in this product right here, psi j, multiplied by 1 in the end. Because let's say psi j didn't have psi 1 in it. Well, then the piece contributing from the j equals 1 piece gives 0. But let's say it has psi 2 in it. Then I get a 1. Let's say it doesn't have psi 3. I get 0. But let's say it had psi 5. Then I get a 1 again. So I get a number of terms contributing based on how big this is. And so in the end, you can show that up to a constant proportionality, the trace of the anticommutator squared for any generic operator, you know, with you know, kind of averaged over flavors, is literally this kind of expectation value. It's a sum over, you know, the projection onto this particular, this is superindex, product of Majorana on a fermion squared, and then you weight them by how many things are in that superindex, how big that product of Majorana on a fermions is. And so it literally is like an average size for the operator. So I took my operator, I projected it along all products of Majorana on a fermions, and I asked, like, what percent, if I think of that as a wave function, what percentage of that operator, you know, is along psi, what, like this product, that would be this thing squared. And I ask, okay, what's like the expected size of this operator? Because it's not just one size or another, it can be a superposition. Well, there's different ways to do that, but here there's kind of a natural way it pops out. You sum the square of all the different coefficients, you know, after normalizing, and then weight them by the size. And that's literally equal to the anticommutator squared. Yeah, that's why there's proportionality. Magnitude of I. Ah, okay. Yeah. So if it's, let's assume the Hamiltonian is bosonic, so it'll preserve Fermi. Yeah. That's why these products of Majorana's will have I's in them as necessary. You can take them all to be Hermitian. It's okay. You can do either one if you want. It's just that one's a little messier. Okay, so now in SYK, I can do every single graph in the theory because I, you know, hate myself, and sum them all up and kind of just project onto like every single possible product of Majorana fermions and ask, you know, what percentage of the oops. Can never get used to the down being forward. What percentage of the operator psi 1 of t is along Majoranas of size 1 plus qn? Because I'm going to do this in the large q limit. So all I get is like size 1 operators, size 1 plus q, size 1 plus 2q, and so on and so forth, to leading order in large q. You could actually have a minus 1, but it's not important. The idea being that it kind of just increments by some number every time. This is the large q limit. And the function we get when we do that, when we resum all these graphs, is this very interesting function right here. Okay, so this is how supported it is along the tree, in a sense. What we find is that at time t, psi 1 of t has kind of a power law decay, so n to the, you know, 1 over n to the 1 minus 2 over q. Q is always bigger than 2, so this is going to be 1 over n to some power less than 1. It's going to be that kind of decay of support until n hits n bar of t. At that point, this exponential becomes important, and this kind of support just drops off exponentially. So in other words, we kind of have some support and then kind of a cutoff. The cutoff occurs at 2 over q times e to the 2 jt. This is the coupling, this is the Atuft coupling associated with the SYK Hamiltonian. So we have the operator supported along the tree until n bar of t, at which point the support drops exponentially. Now, where does that cutoff surface kind of live? It lives at a place that moves exponentially in time. And this is what we're probing when we're probing the anticommutator squared. We're literally, it's kind of like a group velocity, or kind of, it's, you know, the average of this distribution. So of course, if the cutoff of this distribution is moving exponentially in time, the average of this distribution is going to move exponentially in time. That's why the quote unquote infinite temperature chaos exponent for SYK model is 2j. OK, great. So now we have a kind of an interesting notion of how, you know, fermions grow in this all-to-all interacting system. Now keep in mind, this was like a perfectly Milonic approximation, because I had to do large q. But we kind of expect this kind of growth down the tree exponentially. Of course, the pattern might be a little different, but just the notion of that there's more things that the operator might not commute with every single time. And that grows kind of based on the depth. Oops. OK, now, as I mentioned earlier, this OTOC kind of is really useful to diagnose this. So in these large N systems, we tend to notice kind of a sigmoidal behavior in the OTOC. For a very short dissipation-like time, it's going to be kind of a right here. This kind of thermalization as it factorizes. Depends on how you define your otak, it's fine. Okay, then we're gonna have a slow thing as the connected part compared to the disconnected part varies. And then eventually that exponential is gonna be big enough to give us a factor of n, and this drops like a rock. And then it kind of slowly asymptotes to its final value. It might dip below zero depending on what you're calculating, you know, but this is kind of generic trend, this sigmoidal behavior. And as Maldacena and as Juan and Douglas and Steve showed, in large n systems, you know, with some certain assumptions, you can show this behavior is bounded, basically. That rate of the drop has to occur no faster than 2 pi times the temperature. So we noticed that for kind of colder temperatures, just let me finish this slide real quick. For colder temperatures, we notice that the anticommutator squared, its behavior in time, has to be slower than at, you know, say, infinite temperature or something. Or let's just say one temperature and a lower temperature. It has to be slower at that lower temperature. Well, oof, okay, I shouldn't dig myself into a hole there because it could be lower and then go up. But generically speaking, we expect it to slow down as the system gets colder. It's just obvious. Okay, I'm sorry, thank you, Vlad. Oof. No, we dressed all the graphs for psi 1 of t growing into a generic product. So we did like all the 4-point functions where 2 of the operators in the 4-point function are generic size k fermions or whatever, and then the other 2 are size 1 fermions. The analysis I'm going to introduce later in this talk will reproduce these results. You can just take that as the way to derive this. Douglas was very unhappy after learning that I was able to do what we did after like months and like a few lines. But, well, it took more than a few lines, but like, yeah. The later derivations are going to reproduce this if you take the infinite temperature limit. So we can just look at that as the way of deriving it. Ah. Okay. So psi 1 of t always treeifies in that manner we said, and it falls down the tree exponentially with a rate of 2j. That's just true, like ensemble averaged. So why slash how does the anticommutator squared slow down at colder temperatures, but yet is still exponential? Okay, well, you could just say, I don't know, lower energy eigenstates are slower somehow, so rate should be slower, and everything has to work out, so I'll derive the matrix elements such that they happen to make this work out or something. That's not really, I mean, that's true. It's not really satisfying, especially if we're in some type of system that doesn't have any notion of quasi-particles, because at least with a quasi-particle description, we could explain why colder physics is slower. Things don't move as quickly, or there aren't as many excitations at colder temperatures, so we don't expect things to happen as quickly. This is just a very loose intuition. Okay, but what about when we have systems that don't have any, like, you know, dispersion relations, that E goes as P or something like that? Why is it slower at colder temperatures? Like, everyone I'm sure, has their own explanation of why colder physics is slower for any system, even at strong coupling, but the idea here was to try to develop some sort of picture, because we don't really have that many, especially at strong couplings. So let's kind of run with this and see what happens. So as I mentioned, psi 1 of t kind of falls along the tree as e to the 2jt. But we know that when we throw kind of a factor of rho to the 1/2 multiplying it, that can be put in the same equation of the trace, give us kind of a weirdly thermally regulated anticommutator squared. It just has a z2 symmetry. And then this operator can't grow as quickly. It also doesn't start as size 1. It starts as size something plus maybe something that's 1. It starts whatever size this rho to the 1/2 is, which is probably order n. And then maybe it's a bit bigger than that, but I don't know. Do we just have to throw everything out and just, like, you know, work with generating functions or something and just no intuition whatsoever? Well, as it turns out, that is not the case. Otherwise, I wouldn't ask that leading question like that. We will actually be able to develop a useful picture here. So especially since we notice there's still an exponential. And exponentials can kind of naturally come from this kind of tree-like growth in a sense. So it kind of suggests that there might still be something. Now, unfortunately, I won't be able to tell you exactly if there's a natural operator basis to use at lower temperatures. That's actually a whole open question in the field. But I will say something about this UV basis, like how many products of Majorana fermions do I have to write down for this operator? How does that distribution change as a function of time? And we'll notice some very interesting things happening with it. So the first kind of key ingredient that's extremely useful is that we have this kind of reference state. I call it zero. And I didn't write it there. Okay, zero. Some people call it one, it doesn't matter. A reference state, a basis state, special state. Here it's going to be a maximally entangled state. It's going to allow me to realize this anti-commutation algebra in terms of left and right operators. So in particular here, it's something we can really grasp onto. It's going to be kind of a strange entangled vacuum. So all of you are probably familiar that it's more usual to pair Majorana fermions as like 1 and 2 get paired together, 3 and 4 maybe get paired together, however you want to pair them together. But normally they get paired together like on one side, and maybe the other side gets paired together. We have H left and H right or something like that, no problem. But the thing is, here what we're going to do is we're going to create this kind of entangled basis where I'm going to pair them across. So I'm going to say that there's like a generic operator that's like psi 1 left plus I, plus I psi right. And for every single flavor, I'm going to make that annihilate the vacuum. Now keep in mind, there's a conjugate pair to this that will have the minus sign. That will excite the vacuum. So the idea here is that if I apply psi 1 left to this kind of weird entangled vacuum state, then it's the same as applying something times the right fermion, which I can just take as this superposition, which I can just take as the dagger of this thing that annihilated this. And so I can just write a 1 down for this number, and then zeros for everything else. And I can do this for all of them. And what this means is that when I have this operator psi 1 times psi 2 acting on, let's say, this weird vacuum, that's the same as the state 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. Or here, as I indicated, using Benny notation, that like you put a 1 on the left, it's the same as putting 1 on the right, basically, because of this maximally entangled thing. So this is kind of, I was using words like inserting complete sets of operators. You can literally realize a Hilbert space of operators using a, well, there are probably exceptions, but at least in this case, it is easy to realize this Hilbert space where every single like basis state is associated with a particular ordered product of fermions. Of course, there are different bases, but we're going to use this basis because it's particularly useful. So as I said earlier, when we projected out our operator into different products, it's the same as projecting this state, which I'm just going to write like this, because remember, it was just ones and zeros depending on which Majoranas this had. It's the same as projecting this state along these states right here, where these states have 1 and zeros depending on what this product is. And then these numbers will be the same as long as I normalize everything correctly. OK. You can just look at that there, but it's not important. So if I want to understand how maybe this Majorana fermion with one flavor becomes different operators, it's the same as trying to understand as how the left version of this operator, acting upon this Bell pair vacuum, in a sense, grows into the different eigenstates of, in this case, the size operator, which we'll get to in a second. You can use a different basis if you want. It depends on what the question you're studying is. So one of the nice things about writing the doubled Hilbert space in this way is that we can literally write down a size operator that calculates how big the product of Majorana fermions is. And it's exactly what you think it would be. It is just the sum of the the raising and lowering operator for each of these entangled Majorana pairs, in a sense. Okay? And we see that this is proportional to some number times psi j left and psi j right, summed over. OK, and so we see that when we evaluate this thing in some trace, in this instance, of like one product of Majorana fermions and another product, it will only give something non-zero if they are the same size. Then we get this. But remember what I said. Every Majorana fermion has to have a partner in the other one to have a non-zero trace. And so these have to be the same. And so you get that it's orthogonal in this basis. We chose this basis so the size operator would be simple. And so I can literally say that the appropriate minus sign needed, because these are fermions, that this otoc right here is proportional, or varies in a way exactly related to the average size of this weirdo operator that has this kind of rho the 1/2 slapped onto it. So if I calculate this kind of thermally, weirdly thermally regulated otoc, it's mainly just to make it Z2 symmetric, so I can literally call it like a bra and a ket. It is exactly, it changes because this changes, or this changes because that changes. They are the same quantity. Okay? So instead of trying to understand this particular otoc, we can just study, you know, this operator distribution. Or another way of saying it is that the otoc calculates the average size of the products of Majorana fermions. And just one last thing. Yes. That's like a return, that's like a return amplitude type thing. Yeah, sure. Is there light? I'll just give one example rather than writing all time so I don't mess up minus signs. I'm just giving one example, left rather than left right. We could change it back. I shouldn't even write left, excuse me. This is a trace, so it hasn't been doubled yet, unless I want to work with four Hilbert spaces. So asking how much, this having it slapped onto the left is along having it slapped onto the right is related to that Green's function. Now, if we have it slapped onto the same side, it should give one. Yes. Yes. The original Hilbert space, because there's no left or rights. We can make this more complicated and do other things, but this is kind of the idea. So there's another result, but we haven't gone into it yet. The two-point function at its smallest value of beta over 2, the Euclidean two-point function at its smallest value of beta over 2, that's going to be related to the size of rho to the 1/2. It's going to be like 1 minus 2 rho to the 1/2 over n. So in other words, if the two-point function at its lowest possible value in Euclidean time doesn't dip below 0, that means that the average size of rho to the 1/2 never climbs beyond n over 2, no matter what temperature you take. And that indeed happens in SYK, in the large n limit. Mm-hmm. Anything you can write with a Z2 symmetry on the circle. I can draw the circle. Yeah. It'd be easier on the Euclidean circle. And then analytically continuing. So the idea here is that this is kind of a nonlinear thing in the original theory, but becomes a linear operator in the doubled theory. This would be the right, unfortunately, because I drew it in a little opposite direction. And the idea is this would be like the bra, and this would be the ket. So it would be the TFD, except for the fact that we have a single Majorana fermion acting upon it. And this would be the conjugate, in a sense, of the TFD with a single fermion, except there's a single fermion acting upon it. And then we probe that with this linear operator right here that kind of goes between both sides. In other words, this OTOC can be related to an expectation value of a number operator. And if you move these, it's just moving these operators like this. So anything with the Z2 symmetry on the thermal circle can be written as an expectation value of the number operator for Majorana fermions. And then of interest is when we analytically continue this like so and ask about that state. The difference. Yeah. Actually, Juan, Henry, and Ying have a story about the doubled theory, or the two-site SYK model, that's coming out soon, hopefully, ETA 2019. Maybe. Some very interesting stuff there. But yeah, in this case, it's just H left minus H right. If you want to think about it, how to derive that quote unquote, is that if you had this at time t, you would have some u left dagger. But u left acting on this becomes u right. And so we see now that we have like h right minus h left time evolving us. Just a natural way to see why you would get the difference of them as opposed to the sum, the time evolved. And it doesn't stay invariant because we acted upon it with this single simple operator. So this could be a TFD instead or whatever. OK. Great. So OK, that's all fine and dandy to talk about, but I'd like to actually have calculations in this talk. So how do I access this distribution? Well, like most distributions, one way to access it is to throw an exponential with the operator you're interested in, and then some factor that you're eventually going to transform away or backwards with. So I'm going to create this kind of weird kind of grand canonical partition function, in a sense. It's not the normal one. It just looks like one with a mu and an n, by throwing this e to the minus mu n in the middle right here. And that, for me, will generate the percentage of this operator along Majoranas of size n, times power is appropriate to that. OK, still, that's easy to say. In practice, how the hell do we do it? Well, first of all, notice that this kind of looks like an unnormalized two-point function. What I really want it to be like divided by is the same thing, but without the size. But then I'd have to multiply it by that. Well, it turns out that that's kind of this very natural factorization right here of the generating function for this distribution. And what one can show later is that this exactly is going to be a large unfactorization into the disconnected and connected part of the four-point function. Because you want the full four-point function, for instance, you're going to take a derivative of the log of this side with respect to mu and then turn mu off. But on this side right here, you'll get two terms, basically, that you're going to do that to. And that first one of these terms will be the connected part. That's going to be this part right here will give you that. And this part right here will give you the disconnected part. So in a certain sense, this is going to be kind of like the background distribution. It's the distribution associated with the thermofield double or with the rho of the 1/2 factor. So since we have a generating function being as a natural product of two other generating functions, one of which we know is just for rho and the other one we'd like to find, we know that the distribution is going to be a convolution of two distributions, one that is just this kind of background distribution for rho of the 1/2, and one that we'd like to find. Now, as it turns out, and lastly, to find this one right here, we're going to need this kind of weirdo two-point function that has this e to the minus mu in the middle. But as it turns out, if you have e to the minus a number times a bilinear of a left-right operator, at least for Majorana fermions and actually bosons as well, you can turn that into like kind of a path integral boundary condition. So instead of integrating over all fields that do something, you kind of have this requirement that your field on the left and your field on the right twist into each other in a mu-dependent way. So that's just like how you do it. It's not too important for intuition. The most important thing here is why this factorization was helpful. Well, it's that this right here, this kind of background distribution will turn out to be very largely peaked around its average value. This is kind of the fact that thermal fluctuations go as 1 over square root of n. So as a result, this we can kind of maybe approximate as a delta function, and we realize that kind of most of the interesting behavior is coming from this weird twisted two-point function, or at least its transform right here. In other words, kind of the size distribution of this operator, at least in the large n limit, is going to be given by this function shifted to some base value given by rho the 1/2. So it'll start a little bit bigger than rho the 1/2 and keep moving. You can also use this to get a bunch of otoks, like any Z2 symmetric, or you can use this to get all of them, actually. But pretty much the idea being that rather than calculating a four-point function, you can double the theory, turn two of the operators into a left-right pair, move the right one through everything else, put them together, call it an operator, move it into an exponential, and then instead calculate that, because an exponential of a left-right operator is just a boundary condition on the path integral, or on the bras and kets or whatever. And so then all you have to do is calculate a two-point function with a weird boundary condition, which sometimes is easier and sometimes is harder. In this case, it's easier. And if you remember, I said there's a weird boundary condition because of that twist. If you take the derivative of that boundary condition with respect to mu, turn mu off, you literally get the kernel equation for the four-point function. So it's like a weird exponentiation of the kernel equation, in a sense, in like a very non-trivial way that I can't explain more simply than this. And you can do this, and you can get a very nice, clean, short expression for the four-point function in SYK, at least in the large Q limit. And it lets you go to different temperatures, which is nice. That's more of the large Q limit. So let me just tell you what happened. So first thing to mention is that the average size of the thermal state, as I said, was big. It's a big operator, because it has e to the minus something that's going to be order n. So how big is it? Well, it's somewhere off from n over 2, which is kind of like the max size, because there's much more n over 2 size products of Majorana fermions than there are n products. There's only one product of n Majorana fermions. There's a ton of n over 2 products. So it's somewhere off of n over 2. And how close it is depends on just how much lower than the infinite temperature Lyapunov exponent this finite temperature Lyapunov exponent is. So I put a graph of it right here. You have this beta j right here. You can think of this as j in thermal units, or temperature in units of the coupling. That as we get colder and colder, so we have a bigger and bigger term upstairs in the exponential, the operator gets bigger and bigger, as expected, because we're kind of raising e to the minus h to a bigger and bigger power. But it never quite gets past n over 2, which is very interesting. Although this is a large n limit calculation, so that kind of makes sense. You'd expect that maybe at finite n, this would kind of jump a little bit or something in the asymptotic limit. So this is more of a reflection of infinite n. Although something I find very interesting about this is that
this is the average.
Yes.
So an average.
Yes. But a much wider distribution than this will have. Correct. Gaussian. So there's kind of a remnant of finite n in here, I feel like. I'm noticing that it gets harder and harder to make a bigger and bigger operator, in a sense, the closer and closer you get to n over 2. I feel like that's a feature of the fact that n is finite, in a sense. Maybe it's not. Maybe it's just a coincidence. But I just thought that was kind of worth noting. Like, it doesn't just kind of, I mean, I guess what else could it do if it's supposed to be analytic? But like, it's still very interesting that even the infinite n calculation notices that it's kind of harder to make a bigger operator just by keep on multiplying something by itself over and over and over, or to a higher power. That's kind of a more of a finite n effect. So I thought that was a little weird and cute, so I just wanted to mention it. This is basically saying that the two-point function never dips below 0. Like, the two-point function is, yeah. The two-point function at its lowest value, beta over 2, never dips below 0, is saying that this graph never gets above n over 2. Which is interesting, because that's like an infinite n result, but it also reflects some aspects of this finiteness of n. I don't know. Maybe it has nothing to do with it. Maybe it's a coincidence. It's very strange to me that an infinite n calculation has some features that kind of intuitively relate to finite n. Maybe by the end of the talk, I'll get it right, which direction is forward. OK, so We do a lot of work, we get the distribution, and what do we find? We find that it's the exact, basically the exact same distribution. Power law until exponential falloff, location of the falloff grows exponentially in time with some rate. That rate is literally the Lyapunov exponent associated with the anticommutator squared. But this is kind of the thing behind the OTOC. This is the distribution whose average value gives you the OTOC. As such, the kind of time rate associated with that distribution's movement is, of course, going to be the Lyapunov exponent. But it's very interesting that there's this kind of pre-factor right here. We'll talk about that more later. If you want intuition for cold temperatures, remember that lambda is 2 pi over beta. So they'll have you a beta j up here. And the 2 over q we'll talk about later as well. But basically, it's power law until it's not. It just shuts off, basically. And that shut off moves to the right, kind of. We have diffusion. There's diffusion and ballistic. It kind of ballistically moves to the right, but exponentially in time. Or another way of saying it is that log n has like a speed relative to t. So we have kind of the same structure that we got from summing up all these infinite tree graphs after many months of calculations, but just with a different rate. So there still seems to be some sort of weird tree-like structure, maybe. Just if I chose, instead of 2j, like some finite Lyapunov exponent that's not 2j.
So this is a large Q result?
Large Q result.
So like in which order of Q should I have this result?
Leading order. One over Q. Yeah. The large Q approximation actually just, it sums up an infinite subset of the Milonic graphs. So you could just say it's a piece of the answer, if you want, rather than just simply an approximation. You can show that the large Q equations are just summing up all the graphs where you you never thread melons together. I mean, Vlad wrote this. You never thread a melon or put it on another rung. Sorry, you can put another rung. You never thread them together. You can only do things like so. Never here, because there's many more. So imagine there were Q of these lines, where Q is like 700. There's many more places to insert it on these 700 rungs than there is to put it to the left or the right. And when you write down the equations associated with the large Q limit, it's just saying, I want to sum up all such graphs. So that's why I'm saying it's not simply an approximation. It's literally a subset of the planar graphs. Sorry, Milonic graphs, which are a subset of the planar graphs. OK, so we talked about this kind of growth, this tree-like growth. Now, I want to present you guys kind of a modified epidemic model that just is useful for maybe a little bit of intuition. It's really neat how this applies to this theory. So the intuition is that how fast things happen depends on how much has been touched, in a sense, because there's that many more operators upon which the Hamiltonian might not commute, in a sense. Or I'm going to pick up that many more terms in the Hamiltonian that I may not have used before. So that's nice. That's a feature we'd like. And infection models have that, because when the rate of infection is proportional to the number of infected people. Another nice thing about that that's really cool about infection models is that they reflect the finiteness of n. It's not just the infection rate in an infection model is not just proportional to how many infected there are. It's also proportional to how the percentage of people that's not infected yet. Because it's that much harder to have an interaction that with an uninfected person, the less of them there are, even if you have a ton of them. So you kind of sigmoidally approach the world being infected with the generic infection equation. It's just, you know, you get an arctan as a solution. Arctan is a solution. So it's nice because that kind of gives us maybe a hint of how the finiteness of n might show up in this theory. So as I said earlier, an infection equation is just like the rate of infection over, you know, how many infected people there are as a function of time. That rate is proportional to some, you know, number, 2j in our case, times the number of infected people times the percentage of uninfected people. Like what the probability is for an infected person to run into someone who's not sick yet. OK, Now, in SYK, what we see the leading order in N, this is just true. This is not, you know, this is not a derivation of the infection model. This is just a fact that the equations, you know, satisfy. That the percentage, the rate of change of the size of this operator to leading order in N, and since this was a large N calculation anyway, we might as well, you know, do that, is proportional to how big it is. And then 2j. That's basically what the OTOC is going to follow at infinite temperature or the anti-commutator squared. Now, when we go to finite temperature, something really weird happens. So the first thing that's interesting is that right here we have kind of the percentage of uninfected people, but it's raised to a power. It's not just one. Now, where this comes from is the fact that fermions talk to each other in Q local interactions, Q to time. So it doesn't just matter how much percentage of, you know, uninfected fermions there are, it's that percentage to a power, because you have to find like three of them or whatever to grow into. But the really interesting thing aside from that, because that's just more of, that's basically the same thing just with the power because of the Q local nature, is that we don't get a rate that's proportional to the size of the operator. We get a rate that's proportional to the size of the operator minus kind of this background value or this disconnected value, which is kind of weird. It's not just like a pure infection equation. We have to say that like of this population, this much of it doesn't infect others. They just sit there taking up room in the population. Well, how can we think about that in an infection model? A very useful way is to just think of them as people who've gotten vaccines. They just sit there. They participate maybe in interactions, but they don't grow the number of diseased. And they take up some percentage of the world population. As a result, the world gets sick slower because there's a kind of a buffer of people who just can't get sick and don't make other people sick. They're just there. But if you want to ask how fast does the unvaccinated population get sick, the more and more vaccinated people you have, it's slower and slower. You may have heard about this with this whole anti-vaxxer thing that you have to have this, you want this kind of certain amount of people to be vaccinated. It's to slow it down below some critical value so that even if, first of all, vaccines don't always work. Some of you here in this room may not be immune to things you got in vaccines for. That just happens. Let's just accept that as a fact. Okay, but as a population, we'd like those people to get, you know, sick as little as possible. We'd like to avoid that as much as possible. Well, the more and more people have gotten vaccinated, the less and less likely it is someone who may have even gotten vaccinated and is immune to the vaccine, or just someone who's stupid and didn't get a vaccine, gets sick. If more and more population is vaccinated, the mean free path time to get to one of these people who got a vaccine and is immune may be longer than how long the disease is contagious for. And that's this kind of, I forget the name, I'm sorry, you guys. It's just this, there's this name for that. We want some percentage of the population to be vaccinated so that the mean free path time of like disease travel is less than like the contagious time. That's actually, that has an analog in SYK, actually. That's when you couple the two sides together and go to such low temperatures that you don't have this exponential anymore. You get this kind of sinusoiding around n over 2. But that's something more related to what Juan and Ying and Henry will talk about maybe one day. It's really kind of interesting that I didn't even realize that that's analogous. So I did a little simulation just with the equations. Here's like none of the world is vaccinated. The red is infected. This is time, normalized by coupling. And green is how many people are healthy and unvaccinated, I guess. So we have this nice sigmoid. It becomes harder and harder for these red people to interact with the green people because there are just less green people. It's rare and rare for them to find one. And so the rate slows down. We never see this. We never see any part past the inflection point when we do our large N calculations. We only see the exponential part. This is more of this whole Ruel story and stuff like that. People trying to find this late time, either oscillations or asymptoting to the final value. But I put it there so you guys can even see that effect. But no, this is from dn dt equals blah. I'm just plotting the four-point function, basically, equations at infinite m and large q. So if this is some finite temperature, and some of the world is vaccinated, or rho to the 1/2 has some size that's not maximal yet, because we're not at zero temperature, then some of the Majorana fermions aren't infected. But they don't grow either. They don't grow with the Hamiltonian. They just kind of sit there taking up room. As a result, when we infect one, when we have one fermion and we try to grow it, that growth rate, look, the inflection point's like right over here instead of like here. It's slower. Just because these people have to find a green person that's like kind of free to be able to be grown into. Yes, Ying? Yes. 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 If you chose one realization of the Majorana of the ensemble average to evolve time evolved things Lorentzian manner, and you chose another to write down your density matrices, it would be a different. It would be slower, just not nearly as slow. It in fact would have an n in the rate. Because rho the 1/2 would just be a huge generic operator with regards to the time evolution. It would be like if it's at the Ruelle part of the growth. Yeah. In fact, that might be some interesting way to do some Ruelle study. Anyway, because it's not hard to do two realizations of the J averaging. Anyway. So I wanted to give this picture for why there's a slowdown. That we have rho the 1/2, which is just a bunch of half bubbles, okay, because rho is a bunch of bubbles. It's like n of them, but I only want to address 6 because I don't want to fill up this entire screen. And then we have psi 1, which normally just go like 1 and 3 and blah, blah, blah. But now, because rho is next to psi 1, you know, I would have these 5 and like one more. This would be like the first term. Then I'd have the second term, which would just be like growing. This one grows and this one is still there. But because these are kind of sitting there, there's a non-zero chance that one of these half bubbles can act kind of as half of a melon and bring me back down. The reason being that I tried to grow into flavors that were already taken up. Or another way of saying it is that you just want to contract your two interaction vertices. There was one vertex here and one vertex here that got contracted. And the idea being that since we normalize out by these vacuums, that at colder and colder temperature, so this graph right here would get a T times a J, but now we'd have a T and like a beta for a size 1 contribution. So instead of all of our contributions coming from just JT terms, we'd have some contributions coming from beta J, bringing us back down. And this kind of acts as this effective slowdown. That's this picture. OK, so now I want to connect this with ADS a bit. So first thing I need to mention is just to remind you all that in the iconal regime of kinematics, the S matrix for gravitational scattering takes a very simple form. It's basically just the dot product of the two momenta, like for particle 1 and particle 2. And then it'll be multiplied. It'll have some sort of spatial decay that will have like an effective mass because of whatever the horizon curvature is relative to the second derivative of the horizon area. But basically, just this will be some decaying function, maybe exponential, maybe not. And then just kind of S right here, and then Gn. Or in this case, we could have P1 dot P2. So it kind of looks like a boost operator in a sense, because we have, it's like we're boosting P1 by an amount P2. I mean, there is this weird kind of decaying function, but it kind of looks like we're moving P1 forward by an amount, Gn times P2. And in ADS, like in the ADS2 black hole case, you can actually connect these P1s and P2s, which are really local quantities. Because in the iconal regime, space-time is flat, basically, for all you care about, because the scattering happens so quickly and over so small of a range that they just kind of go and scatter. And they only feel some aspects of the curvature, but not all of it. But then in ADS, we can connect these local momenta to these global charges, these like P plus and P minus in ADS. And we can see that, in fact, like in ADS2, that if we have, say, O left and O right for any conformal primaries, and we're calculating them with some other conformal primaries, we're calculating this kind of scattering amplitude right here, we'll see that in a certain limit that gives us the iconal regime, P plus will always show up in a universal manner. Or another way of saying this is that if I have a theory that's related to some ADS2 black hole, I can always extract P plus from this, in a sense. And then if you go the other direction in time, this will be P minus. So this is what I meant right here, that if you take t to infinity, but you hold g Newton times e to the 2 pi t over beta fixed while taking that limit, then any bilinear, so I just move the t's out here onto these. Any bilinear fermion, of conformal primaries, time evolved, will be some function of the p plus or p minus operator, depending on what you're doing. So this is just a little bit of intuition for why in the ADS2 black hole case, certain four-point functions grow exponentially in time. They're measuring kind of the p plus, the initial p plus, but then that p plus gets evolved. And that's how you pick up this time factor right here. And it gets evolved with this kind of boundary boost, or Rindler time, if you want. And so we can ask the question, if I have a free massless particle in an ADS2 system, also known as the ADS2 black hole, and I drop it from the boundary, then I ask myself, if I time evolve that using like h left minus h right, what percentage of that state is along states of definite, you know, global energy delta plus n for whatever n I'm interested in? Asking the question, as this operator falls, how is it supported across operators of different global energy? And what you find is you find a very familiar function. You have a power law decay with a certain power of 1 minus 2 delta until a certain n bar, at which point the decay shuts off and you effectively have no support of the operator. The location of that shutoff moves exponentially in time with regards to this, you know, evolution that we're using. And there'll be some epsilon depending on the smearing, the Euclidean smearing for whatever I'm doing. Now, as we saw in SYK, we had the exact same, essentially, evolution, except with one factor. The location of our average has a kind of a beta j over pi in the holographic limit. Where does that come from? That comes from the fact that a SYK fermion and a conformal primary do not apply the same amount of global energy to the TFD. The conformal primary, if unsmeared, applies an infinite amount of energy, a boundary conformal primary, but an SYK fermion can apply at most j. So that's just a remnant of, you know that the scrambling time depends on how much energy you injected? That's just kind of showing that. You can just throw that up into this time right here, kind of treat that as a part of your dissipation time that you have to wait, and it's the same distribution. Up. Yes, I'll tell you after, though. So I just want to, last slide. And what's really interesting is that this is basically the tree. Remember, Douglas, Dan, and I did this calculation at infinite temperature, just pure tree graphs, no betas, whatever. It's the same. We got the same function. The only difference was that we had this lambda right here being equal to 2j, and this one right here. But then what we saw is that in the large Q limit in SYK, at any temperature, this is the form of the kind of the growth distribution. How much kind of shifted the distribution of rho to the 1/2 times psi 1 of t is from rho to the 1/2. That's this right here. That's how shifted it is in size. And that shift location moves exponentially in time with some rate that's going to give us, that will directly diagnose via the OTOC or the anti-commutator squared. So in other words, the falling of this kind of simple operator across this tree kind of mirrors, in a sense. I won't say is exactly the same or maps to exactly, but mirrors, in a sense, a precursor state kind of falling in. So you can either say we slide this further and further back in time, and at time t equals 0, ask how much global energy it has, or we can just try to follow this forward and ask at some Rindler time t how much global energy it has. So it's very interesting that they both follow kind of tree-like equations. Now, SYK, the fermion squared to 1, conformal primary is never squared to 1. So that's just kind of, but that just pretty much just only causes this difference right here. Aside from that, it's the same equations you get from something on a tree, growing tree-like, or all-to-all interaction-like. So I thought that was very interesting. And we were able to kind of localize and identify this effect, that small operators become bigger operators in kind of a quasi-local way, because we didn't have any space. And we had this large Anatoof limit that made it possible. So thank you.